In this lecture, we are going to study mechanisms for processes to communicate with each other. So in general, two processes do not share any memory with each other. Each process has its own separate memory image, its own separate code, heap, stack, data, and so on, right? So if two processes want to work together, one process wants to pass on some information, some bytes to another process, how is this accomplished? The operating system provides certain mechanisms called inter-process communication or IPC mechanisms for this purpose. So in this lecture, we are going to study at a high level some of the IPC mechanisms available in modern operating systems. So these mechanisms will enable two processes to share memory or information or bytes with each other and communicate. So the first mechanism is what is called shared memory. That is, two processes can both get access to a region, the same region of memory, right? So both of them call this system call share memory get, and this returns a pointer to a memory area. And both processes can access the same memory area. So one process can put some information, the other in that memory area, the other process can read it, and so on, right? So this is the simplest way in which two processes can communicate with each other. Of course, if you want to build a real system that uses shared memory, there are a few other things you have to take care of. For example, how do you make sure that both processes are not writing to the same memory at the same time? Which process should write where? Which process should read from where? The processes need a little bit more coordination, right? Shared memory is just like a blank whiteboard that two processes can write onto. Okay, so other issues on how do you build a real system with shared memory, there's a little more complexity involved in there. So the next idea is the concept of signals, right? So signals are sort of well-defined messages or signals that can be sent to processes, right? And some of these signals have a fixed meaning. For example, there's a signal to kill or terminate a process. Right, that signal, when a process receives that signal, it's always terminated. But there are also some other signals which can be defined to mean whatever you want, right? So a signal can be sent to a process either by the operating system or by another process, right? So a signal can come to a process from any source. And when a process gets a signal, a code called the signal handler is executed. Okay, so processes come with a default code for what to do for each signal, right? For example, when you press Control C on the keyboard, then the operating system will send a interrupt signal to whichever process is running in the foreground. And when this process gets the interrupt signal, it will be interrupted. That is the meaning of this signal, right? The process will stop whatever it is doing. Similarly, if you send the kill signal, a process will be terminated. So certain signals have a default meaning because the signal handler code makes the process do a certain action when it receives a signal. But some of these signal handlers can be overridden, right? You can write your own signal handler for a certain signal. For example, when you get a certain signal, you can override the default signal handler code and say I want to do something else. When you get Control C, you can write signal handler code that prints out something before the process terminates, for example, right? Of course, some signal handlers cannot be overridden, right? A process cannot override the signal handler to terminate, then it will run forever, so you do not want such situations. But some set of signals can be redefined and you can make a process do certain actions when it receives a signal by overriding the signal handler, right? This is one way in which two processes can communicate with each other by sending signals to each other. Of course, you cannot pass on a set of bytes or messages through these signals, but you can, it's just like one process poking another process, and this process can do a certain specific action when that signal arrives. The next mechanism is what are called sockets. So if you've taken a networking course, you would have heard of sockets. There are TCP or UDP sockets for two different applications on two different machines to communicate with each other, right? So it's the same socket that we can use for two processes in the same machine to also communicate, right? So there are two different processes. These can be on different machines or they can be on the same machine. And each process opens a socket, and you can connect these sockets with each other, and then you can send and receive information. So this process can write something into the socket, and whatever is written here, this process can read. Similarly, this process can write something into the socket that can be read over here, right? And if these two processes are on different machines, you use a TCP or a UDP socket because you need some network layer protocol to transmit messages across machines. But if these two processes are on the same machine, then you do not need a TCP or UDP stack. You can simply use simple Unix sockets to communicate with other processes on the same machine. But the interface, the system calls to create sockets and read write to them remain the same in both of these situations. Okay, there are system calls to open a socket, to connect two sockets to each other, to read into a socket, to read from a socket, to write into a socket, and so on. And when you write into a socket, there are certain buffers at the operating system level where the messages are stored, and when another process reads from the socket, the message is delivered from the receive buffer of the socket, right? So under the hood, the operating system is taking care of passing on the messages from the buffers of one socket to the buffers of another socket. You can look at more example code to fully understand how to write programs that communicate with each other using sockets. Another mechanism similar to sockets is pipes. Just that, a pipe is a half duplex communication. That is, you can only send data one way. So there's a system call to create a pipe. When you create a pipe system call, it returns two file descriptors. Right? Recall that a file descriptor is simply a handle using which you can read or write to files. You can also read or write into sockets or pipes using a file descriptor. So the pipe system call returns two file descriptors. One file descriptor is the write end, and the other file descriptor is the read end, right? This is only a half duplex communication. So you have these two file descriptors in your program. You can write into one file descriptor and you can read from the other file descriptor, and whatever is written here will come out the other end, okay? So regular pipes, by default, both of these file descriptors are in the same process, okay? But how is this useful? Why will a process want to communicate with itself using pipes? In reality, what happens is, the way pipes are used is, parent and the child share the same file descriptors after fork, right? So the parent creates a pipe and then it forks, it creates a child process which also has access to the same pipe, okay? So the parent's file descriptor and the child's file descriptor are both pointing to the same pipe. And then what happens? The parent closes one file descriptor and the child closes the other file descriptor, so that this through this file descriptor the parent will write and through this file descriptor the child can read, right? So given that a process would not want to communicate with itself, there's no point having both the read end and the write end of the file, both file descriptors, both ends of the pipe in the same program. Therefore, when you create a pipe, you make multiple copies of yourself and you give different ends of the pipe to different child processes so that they can communicate with each other, right? So this is the standard way in which pipes are used to communicate between parent and child processes. Or there's also another mechanism called named pipes, where two different processes can get two endpoints of the same pipe, right? A pipe has a name, and if both processes ask for the same pipe with the same name, they can get, one of them can get the read end of the pipe and the other can get the write end of the pipe. They can get file descriptor handles to these and then they can read and write using named pipes, right? Unnamed pipes can only be used within the same process or within the children of the same process. And again, much like sockets, when you write into a pipe, this data is buffered in a kernel buffer. And when you read from it, it is provided from the same buffer. Similarly, another mechanism is that of message queues. So a message queue is nothing but a mailbox, right? A process can open a mailbox at a certain path name, and then other processes can send messages to the mailbox, and this process can receive messages from the mailbox, right? You have the send abstraction and the receive abstraction on the mailbox. And when a process sends to a mailbox, the operating system buffers these messages, and another process can read and receive these messages from the mailbox. This is also another way in which processes can communicate with each other. And across all of these mechanisms, you should realize that this communication between processes can either be blocking or non-blocking. Okay? For example, in the case of a pipe, right? Suppose this process has written a lot of data into the pipe and the pipe is full. So now, when you try to write again, this write can either block, saying there's no more data, therefore the write will not return, or it can be a blocking system call, or it can, the write can simply return with an error message saying I could not finish writing because there's no space in the pipe. Okay. Similarly, when you're reading from a pipe, if the pipe has no data and you try to read, this read system call can either block, saying there's no further data and the process will become ready to run only when some data arrives, or the read can simply return saying I couldn't find any bytes in the pipe, right? So for all IPC mechanisms, you can either invoke the communication in a blocking fashion or a non-blocking fashion, and this choice depends upon the particular application you have in mind.